Hello there, Detective Chester Chesterton on the case of Clue, of trying to solve this mystery of who was murdered, why they were murdered, and where and when they were murdered. Now last week I was scouring all over, looking for a body and a blood. But sometime last week after I took those clues to Pastor Nathan and he told me everything about them, I had an epiphany. This epiphany was that if this body truly was murdered 2,000 years ago, there wouldn't be a body of blood. There would be bones. So this whole past week, I was scouring over the earth for any type of bonage or anything like that, looking for something that might be white and buried underground. But something very peculiar occurred, because I only found two things. The two things that I found were most interesting, because the first things that I found in my digging and uncovering were nails. Now these nails had little bits of red all over them and I wasn't quite sure what they were, so I sent them to the lab, as they call it here, in Anderson, South Carolina, to look and see what type of red substance that was, if it was indeed blood or something else of the sort. The other things that I found, as these are found most commonly everywhere, were rocks. Now, both of these things, not necessarily the most helpful clues, but I'm coming to some sort of conclusion that maybe there was never a murder. But if there was a murder, that now this person who has been murdered is no longer murdered. Now, I don't believe in zombies or mummies or ghosts or anything like that, but I fear that we may have something like that on our hands, which means that this is a much bigger case than just Detective Chester Chesterton. So what I think we should do is bring these two clues to Pastor Nathan and see if he can provide any more answers or wisdom on this matter. Let's take it to him now. Hey Hope Kids, I am so happy that you are back and joining us for whatever week it is of Hope Kids at Home. This week we are learning about something so, so special and important to our faith as Christians. Now, right before this, a man that I think you have met already named Chester Chesterton came up to me. He's the detective that I put on this case to figure out this mystery that we're going through. I just went online and was looking for all these detectives and found that he was one of the best. So he has come to me with some pieces of evidence and also two possible conclusions to this case, which I found pretty interesting. But he came to me, one with some nails. He came to me with some nails, which I found was pretty ironic for what we're going through today, and then also a piece of a larger rock. So that's what he's come to me today with, and he was telling me that his two conclusions are either that this murder either never took place, or two, that somehow the person who was murdered is now back to life. Now what we're going to learn about today is something incredibly important to our faith as Christians, known as the resurrection. Can everyone say the resurrection sitting on your couches? Awesome, thank you. So today we are gonna learn about the resurrection, and what we're gonna do is we are actually gonna look at some testimonials found in a book called The Bible, and we are going to look at some more pieces of evidence to help draw these clues that Chester found, like the nails and the piece of the rock. We're gonna use these clues and this piece of evidence to find out just exactly what happened to Jesus. So here's John chapter 19 in the Jesus Storybook Bible. "So, you're a king, are you?" the Roman soldiers jeered. "Then you'll need a crown and a robe." They gave Jesus a crown made out of thorns and put a purple robe on him and pretended to bow down to him. "Your majesty," they said. Then they whipped him and spat on him. They didn't understand that this was the Prince of Life, the King of heaven and earth, who had come to rescue them. The soldiers made him a sign, "Our King," and nailed it to a wooden cross. They walked up a hill outside the city, and Jesus carried the cross on his back. Jesus had never done anything wrong, but they were going to kill him the way the criminals were killed.
They nailed Jesus to the cross. "Father, forgive them," Jesus gasped. "They don't understand what they're doing." "You say you've come to rescue us," people shouted, "but you can't even rescue yourself." But they were wrong. Jesus could have rescued himself. A legion of angels would have flown to his side if he'd called. "If you were really the Son of God, you could just climb down off that cross," they said. And of course, they were right. Jesus could have just climbed down. Actually, he could have just said a word and made it all stop, like when he healed that little girl or stilled the storm and fed 5,000 people. But Jesus stayed. You see, they didn't understand. It wasn't the nails that kept Jesus there. It was love. "Dad," Jesus cried, frantically searching the sky. "Dad, where are you? Don't leave me." And for the first time and the last, when he spoke, nothing happened. Just a horrible, endless silence. God didn't answer. He turned away from his boy. Tears rolled down Jesus' face, the face of the one who would wipe away every tear from every eye. Even though it was midday, a dreadful darkness covered the face of the world. The sun could not shine. The earth trembled and quaked. The great mountains shook. Rocks split in two until it seemed that the whole world would break, that creation itself would tear apart. The full force of the storm of God's fierce anger at sin was coming down on his own son instead of his people. It was the only way God could destroy sin and not destroy his children whose hearts were filled with sin. Then Jesus shouted in a loud voice, "It is finished!" And it was. He had done it. Jesus had rescued the whole world. "Father," Jesus cried, "I give you my life." And with a great sigh, he let himself die. Strange clouds and shadows filled the sky, purple, orange, and black, almost like a bruise. Jesus' friends gently carried Jesus. They laid Jesus in a new tomb carved out of rock. How could Jesus die? What had gone wrong? What did it mean? They didn't know anything anymore except that they knew their hearts were breaking. "That's the end of Jesus," the leaders said. But just to be sure, they sent strong soldiers to guard the tomb. They held a huge stone in front of the door to the tomb so that no one could get in or out. Jesus' friends were sad. They would never see their best friend again. How could this happen? Wasn't Jesus the rescuer, the King God had promised? It wasn't supposed to end like this. Yes, but whoever said anything about the end? Just before sunrise on the third day, God sent an earthquake and an angel from heaven. When the guards saw the angel, they fell down with fright. The angel rolled the huge stone away, sat on top of it, and waited. At the first glimmer of dawn, Mary Magdalene and the other women headed to the tomb to wash Jesus' body. The early morning sun slanted through the ancient olive trees, drops of dew glittering on leaves and grasses, little tears everywhere. The friends walked quietly along the hilly path through the olive groves until they reached the tomb and immediately noticed something odd. The tomb was wide open. They peered through the opening into the dark tomb, but wait, Jesus' body was gone. And something else, a shining man standing there with clothes made from lightning. "Don't be scared," the angel said, but they couldn't help it anyways. They screamed anyway. The angel asked them, "What are you doing here? This is a tomb, and tombs are for dead people." The women couldn't speak. "Jesus isn't dead anymore," he said. "He's alive again." And their hearts leapt, and then the angel laughed with such gladness that they felt for a moment as if they had woken from a nightmare. So what we just read about Jesus coming back to life helps us with two things. The first is helping us tie together the clues that Chester Chesterton brought us, that in fact this nail were the nails that Jesus was pierced with and held to on the cross, and that this rock was a part of the tomb that was rolled away when he came back to life. And the second is that we know that Jesus was in fact murdered, but also that he came back to life, so therefore he was resurrected, raised from the dead. Came back to life, not like a zombie or a mummy or anything else like that, but as the true king of our hearts. And so I want to ask us a question, because this event, the resurrection, Jesus coming back to life, is so important to our Christian faith, because me and my heart believing in the resurrection is what makes me a Christian, is what helps me to have a friendship with Jesus for the rest of my life. So what I want to ask is what makes the resurrection so important? Why does this bring me such good news and joy? And so to do that, I want to illustrate it. I want to imagine that we all have report cards. Now, I know that you know what a report card is because most of you are in school, and so you guys get A's, B's, hopefully not C's or D's or F's, but if you do, it's okay. You can always get better. But I want us to imagine that we have a report card on life. This is my report card, and God gives me this report card as I walk through life. Now, we have different subjects in life, like obeying your parents, like generosity or kindness or telling the truth, putting yourself last and loving others, and so many more subjects that we are potentially graded on in our life. Now, I want you just for a second to think about what kind of grades that you would get so far in your life. How about on obeying your parents? Do you think you would get an A? Are your parents sitting there laughing at you if you've just said an A? Are you thinking about a C, a D? What about generosity, kindness, being honest, putting yourself last, loving others? What grades do you think you get? You see, for a lot of us, we think that we get maybe B's, maybe an A in some of those, and maybe C's. But in reality, because of sin, the thing that separates us from God, every single one of us on our report card has an F. Not just in one subject, but in every single subject of life. Now let's put that aside for a second and let's go to somebody else's report card. Let's go to Jesus' report card, because he also had a report card while he was here walking on earth. A report card for just the same subjects that we will go through. Every single one of them. So I want you to imagine for a second, what do you think are on Jesus' report card? What grades? Now I hope none of you said anything less than an A, because in fact, Jesus on his report card gets A pluses on every single thing, 100%. He never fails. He was perfect in his time walking on here. So what makes the resurrection so important, Pastor Nathan? What makes the resurrection so important is that God takes my report card with all the F's inside of it and Jesus's report card with all the A pluses inside of it. And what he does at the point of Jesus coming back to life after taking every single one of our sins upon him that we ever have done, that you are doing right now, or that we will ever do, he takes every single one of our sins, he takes them out of his report card, or out of our report card, puts them into his report card, and puts all of his A pluses into ours. So that when God comes to our life and he looks at Pastor Nathan's report card, because of my eternal friendship in Jesus through my belief in the resurrection, that when God opens my report card, he finds all A's. This is what we celebrate on Easter, the fact that what Jesus did on the cross and what he did through coming back to life again helps us and gives us the only way we can have an eternal friendship with God. And that's through having all A's in every subject of life, not because of anything that you can do or that I can do. We can never work our way into heaven. We can never be a good enough person. But by believing in Jesus, he gives us his heart, his grades, so that when God looks onto us, he sees a perfect child of God because of what Jesus did on the cross and through his resurrection. That's what we celebrate on Easter. And the beautiful part about all of this is all we have to do to get Jesus's grades, all we have to do to have an eternal friendship with God forever and ever and ever, is to invite Jesus into our hearts, to say, Jesus, I love you. I don't have all the answers. I don't know everything yet, but I want you in my heart. I want to live forever with you. I invite you right now that if you haven't done that yet in your life, whether you're in kindergarten or whether you are 85 years old watching this with your grandkids, I encourage you to make that decision to invite Jesus into your heart. He's waiting to come into your heart. He wants to come into your heart and have an eternal forever friendship with you. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, we thank you so much for this wonderful opportunity that we have to come to these kids' homes through a TV, a computer screen, an iPad, whatever it is, God. God, I pray that right now while they are watching this, that you work in their hearts to show them that all they have to do to get all A's and all they have to do to be a perfect child of God is to invite your son Jesus into their hearts, God. We love you. We thank you for this amazing thing that we get to celebrate. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Have a great week, guys. I hope you guys tune in next week. We love you guys, and we miss you guys.